This game of baseball is only one half skill. The other half is something else. Something bigger. You gotta have heart. Oh, you really...
In 1898, the William Morris Talent Agency was opened at 43 West 28th Street. 57 years later, a project started by William Morris debuted on Broadway, a musical based on a baseball-themed novel, the year the Yankees lost the pennant. Damn Yankees won 7 Tony Awards, including Best Musical. Another 57 years later, William Morris, known as WMEIMG, became the world's largest sports and entertainment agency. The New York Clipper also blossomed. Launched in Lower Manhattan in 1853, as the first nationally distributed publication devoted to sports and entertainment, the Clipper moved, 57 years later, to offices 2 doors down from William Morris. In 1856, the newspaper published the Knickerbocker Baseball Rules, a key development in baseball's spread westward. In 1857, the Franklin Baseball Club in Detroit, perhaps the first club outside of the Northeast, started after its founders read the rules in the Clipper. That year, Henry Chadwick, a New York Times cricket writer, joined the Clipper. He would become known as Father Baseball. For many years, Chadwick pushed for rules changes he felt would improve the game. For example, he successfully campaigned to change the rule that players could catch the ball for an out after one bounce and became the chairman of baseball's rules committee. Among the baseball developments for which Chadwick is credited are batting average, earned run average, and a popular scoring mark.
In baseball parlance, you write on the score called K. K means strikeout, so it's a big fat capital K.
In April 1908, the 83-year-old Chadwick caught pneumonia at an early season game between the Giants and Brooklyn and died 6 days later, with a legacy that includes pioneering the charting of comparative sports statistics.
One of the most spectacular features at Shea Stadium will be the most modern scoreboard in the major league, a scoreboard that will be a show in itself.
A young New Yorker who had never been to a professional baseball game made his mark on the sport the same year Henry Chadwick died. The young man was on the 9th Avenue elevated train and saw an advertisement that read, "Baseball Today, Polo Grounds." Inspired, he started writing song lyrics and took his words to music's famous Tin Pan Alley. Tin Pan Alley stretched from 5th Avenue to 6th Avenue on 28th Street, a hub for songwriters and music publishers from the late 19th to the middle of the 20th century. Tin Pan Alley in time became the nickname for the entire music industry. The lyricist from the train took his words to Albert von Tilzer, a composer who worked from his own recording house, York Music Company, at 40 West 28th Street. Von Tilzer provided the music for history's most performed sports song, "Take Me Out to the Ball Game," the unofficial anthem of North American baseball during the 7th inning stretch.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jacks. I don't care if I ever get
that. In 1958, on his hit national primetime variety show from Midtown Manhattan, Ed Sullivan welcomed Take Me Out to the Ball Game's writer to sing the song with 4 Yankees players: Whitey Ford, Yogi Berra, Mickey Mantle, and Moose Scourin.
His name is Jack Norwood.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the ball. Buy me the peanuts and Cracker Jacks. I don't care if I never get back.
Sullivan, a Harlem native, lettered in baseball and basketball in high school, then struggled to make a living before becoming a successful Manhattan sports writer and sports editor. In one column, Sullivan coined a nickname for teenage American tennis champion Helen Wills, Little Miss Poker Face, that became a universal nickname throughout a career that included 7 U.S. national singles championships and 8 Wimbledon singles titles. In 1924, Sullivan was a sports writer at the Morning Telegraph and was close there with a fellow Telegraph sports writer, John Fitzgerald. On a Morning Telegraph sports page, Fitzgerald coined the term the Big Apple. He used it in horse racing coverage as a metaphor for victory. It became the name of Fitzgerald's column and New York City's nickname. Like Fitzgerald, Sullivan's New York sports platform would allow him to transcend sports.
Ed, you know, I'd like to say something about you. Now, don't you stop me either. Meeting you for the first time after a not an important fight, getting to meet you, I didn't realize I'd be so relaxed talking to you. I know the boys in the gym feel the same way as I do. We really love you.
Sullivan's television program aired from 1948 to 1971 and finished as high as second in the annual TV ratings. His influence included the launch of the mass American popularity of Elvis Presley and the Beatles after he gave them their national television debuts to a combined viewership of 130 million.
Here they are, the champion Mets, singing, "You've Gotta Have Heart." So let's have a fine.
Sullivan was proud to have had dozens of sports guests on the show, from the 1969 Miracle Mets to many others before they reached the height of their athletic achievements, including University of Florida quarterback Steve Spurrier, Cassius Clay, who became Muhammad Ali, and 15-year-old Manhattan High School basketball star Lou Alcindor, who would also change his name to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Mister, you can be a hero. You can open any door. There's nothing to it but to do it. You gotta.